thank you. Especially thank you to you, Jeremy, for taking the risk of inviting me. I'll certainly gain a lot in this meeting because virology and immunology are somehow merging into our field of interest, which is the use of viruses, which are called oncolytic viruses, as anti-cancer agents. So in my presentation, I would like first to devote the first part to a general description, an overview of the field of cancer viral therapy, and then I'll exemplify the development of this field with the viruses we are more specifically working with, namely the oncolytic parvoviruses. So let's start just with a general introduction of the field. It's not the concept on which this field is based, it's not a new concept. Already 50 years ago or more, occasional cases of unexpected tumor remissions were described and in association with infection of patients with viruses. This is one example of a Burkitt lymphoma, which was found to regress in association with an infection of the measles virus. But these cases could not be understood in great detail and exploited because of the lack of tools at those times. And it's only with the advent of molecular virology and genetic engineering that the field underwent a revival in the last two or three decades. And it's now a very active field of biomedical research. These works showed, using cell cultures, that indeed some viruses are endowed with oncolytic properties, and this is the schematical behavior of a perfect oncolytic virus. This virus should, I knew that I would do it. I warned you. Sorry, what did I do wrong?
I think then, that's
fine. Yeah. So the an oncolytic virus should ignore a normal cell. Either it should fail to enter the normal cell, or if it enters, as here, it should not replicate within the cell, and the cell should be happy. And in contrast, the virus should penetrate the cancer cells, get multiply in this cell, leading to the lysis of the cell, the release of progeny particles, which can then propagate through several secondary rounds of infection, the lytic wave through the tumor. And a number of viruses were found to have such properties. And of course, the key to this mechanism is the oncoselectivity. Why does, how does the virus distinguish between the cancer and the tumor cells? And this could be traced back to differences, to features, which distinguish the tumor cells from the normal cells and on which the virus is dependent. And these features are listed here, and these properties, these features of tumor cells make tumors preferential niches for the replication of the oncolytic viruses. Now, some viruses are not naturally oncoselective. They have to be engineered in order to acquire this oncoselectivity. And this is exemplified here for the viruses circled in red. Normally, these viruses are able to antagonize the antiviral defense mechanism, the type 1 interferon response. If this function, this evasion of from the interferon response is inactivated through appropriate deletions, for instance, the virus is now not able to evade the interferon response. It will fail to replicate in normal cells, but it will still keep the capacity for replicating in many tumor cells because the tumor cells are often deficient in the type 1 interferon response. So this is one type of modifications which is being used to make a non-oncoselective virus more oncoselective. Some other oncolytic viruses are naturally oncoselective, and the viruses I'm going to talk about later on, the protoparvoviruses we are working with, are used as wild-type viruses, and these viruses depend on several functions which are present and provided more specifically by the tumor cells. I will illustrate this briefly later on. They are dependent on the uncontrolled proliferation of the tumor cells and also on the resistance of these tumor cells to death mechanisms under stress conditions. And the virus is developing these functions for its own benefit, leading to its preferential replication in the tumor cell. Now, oncolysis, so the direct killing of the tumor cells by the virus, represents only one facet of the suppression of tumors by oncolytic viruses. actually these viruses were found to also exert bystander effects. For instance, they can disrupt the vasculature, the tumor vasculature, leading to a reduction of the perfusion of the tumor and the induction of necrosis. But more important, especially for this meeting, they also have immunomodulating effect. They can either infect directly immune cells, leading to their activation, or they can activate immune cells by inducing an immunogenic type of tumor cell death. And this leads to a tumor activation, which can then antagonize, can lead to the destruction not only of the virus-infected cells, but also on non-infected cells. And this is a key factor of success for viral therapy, because it's it would be mistaken to think that the multiplication of the virus in the organism would be so efficient that all the cells in the tumor will be hit by the virus and died by the virus. The success of the viral therapy relies mostly on these bystander effects, and the immune system, of course, is the prime system to achieve this bystander killing of the tumor cells, and I'll give some examples of this later on. So this is also represented schematized on this slide. The important aspect is, of viral therapy is the induction of inflammatory changes in the macroenvironment of the tumor. The virus-infected tumor cells are lysed. This leads to the release of tumor-associated antigens, but also of damage or pathogen-associated molecular patterns, which are known to activate regulatory or effector immune cells. And this is a key property of many oncolytic viruses to trigger this, to create this local inflammation and this microenvironment, which is favorable for tumor rejection. Oops. Now, about 20 different viruses prove to have such oncolytic and immunostimulating properties, and half of them, 12, are now the subject of clinical trials, and these are the oncolytic viruses presently put to the clinical trial. So as you can see, a variety of viruses are being used. There are DNA viruses, RNA viruses of different types, with envelope, without envelope, different complexity. Some are very small, some are very big, and actually the ones we are working with are here. They are smallest and the less complex ones in the whole series of oncolytic viruses presently tested. These different oncolytic viruses are at different stages of clinical evaluation. Most of them are still in phase 1-2, but some reach phase 3. For instance, an oncolytic herpes virus is likely to be approved this year by the FDA for release as a drug, in particular against melanoma. The effect of this virus is illustrated on this slide, which shows that indeed these viruses act in part through bystander effect. So this is we look here at the effect of non-colytic herpes viruses called TVEC or Oncovex. And in a melanoma patient, these viruses causes the remission of the lesion which is injected with the virus, but also distant lesions and also metastasis in lymph nodes or in the lung. Now, this data, of course, are very intriguing, challenging. And the overall outcome of these clinical trials is summarized on this slide. About 1,000 patients have been tested in over 100 clinical trials. And the three main proof of concepts milestones have been reached: safety and evidence for lytic infection of the tumors, and also tumor suppression. But it's clear that the field is still a field of research and development. For instance, this trial using the oncolytic virus, which will be approved probably this year by the FDA, showed that there was a very striking, impressive improvement in durable response, but still the overall increase in survival endpoint was just missed. So there is a need for improving the efficiency of the treatment, and the field is a field of active research. One tries to improve the known viruses, to discover new oncolytic viruses, to combine oncolytic viruses with different treatments. There are a number of strategies which are now being developed for improving the outcome of the viral therapeutic treatment. And I would like to illustrate now these developments in the case of the parvoviruses we are working on with in the lab. These are called protoparvoviruses. This is a work that we developed in the German Cancer Center in Heidelberg in cooperation with the University Hospital in Heidelberg and a company, Oryx, which is sponsoring all the clinical developments, because we'll see this work led to a first clinical trial. These viruses are called rodent protoparvoviruses, and as the name indicates it, their natural hosts are rodents. They are endemic in rodent population, and we are in particular working with a virus called H1, and the natural host of H1 is the rat, but still H1 is of interest for human applications because it can target a number of human tumor cells. This is a simplified identity card of H1. This is a non-envelope, very small viruses having the size of a ribosomal subunit. The genome is only 5,000 nucleotides long, so it is 1 million times smaller than the genome of the human cell, but it infects, and it's only two transcript encodes. It comprises only two transcription units, so its genetic complexity is very limited. The life cycle of the virus is depicted in a very simplified way here. The parvoviruses, or protoparvoviruses, are nuclear replicating viruses, so there is a transfer of the virus in the nucleus where DNA replication, viral DNA replication, gene expression, and also at a later stage, assembly of particles takes place. Now, if these viruses are quoted as oncolytic, it's because this cycle doesn't happen in all cells. It takes place preferentially in tumor cells, and this could be traced back to the stimulation of the steps which are circled in red, in particular DNA replication, gene expression, and cytopathic effects, because this cycle leads to a multitude of cytopathic effects and eventually culminating in the death of the cells. Now, the molecular mechanisms underlying the stimulation of the culminating in the death of the cells. So the molecular mechanisms are not fully understood, and I think it's not the scope of this meeting to go into detail. I'll just show one illustration of the reason why these viruses are more oncotoxic, that is more toxic for tumor cells, neoplastic cells, compared to normal cells. And this shows the dependence of these viruses on two features of tumor cells, the uncontrolled proliferation and the dependence of survival pathway under stress conditions. We could show, for instance, that the replication of the viral DNA, and the viral DNA is single-stranded, but it ends up in hairpins, which are extended, converting the single-stranded DNA into a double-stranded form, which is a transcription template and used for the subsequent steps of the cycle. This very initial event of viral DNA replication depends on cyclin A, which is induced in S phase, making these viruses S phase dependent, and therefore the uncontrolled proliferation of at least a fraction of the cells in a tumor makes these cells preferential tumors for the virus. On the other hand, another example is illustrated here. Signaling cascades are known to be activated in tumor cells, and we identified recently this cascade here, an abnormal activation of the PKC, PDK, PKB cascades, which contribute to the survival of the tumor cells under stress conditions. And this same cascade was found to be responsible for the phosphorylation of a viral protein, which is called NS1. And this is a key factor for both the replication and the cytotoxic activity of the virus. And in order to be active, this protein has to be phosphorylated. And this kinase cascade is responsible for this phosphorylation, linking the replication and toxicity of the virus to the transformation, the malignant transformation of the cells. Now, once the virus replicates, it expresses this protein, and this NS1 protein is by itself is able to induce the death of the cells. And this complicated slide is just shown to indicate that this death process involves multiple steps, multiple pathways. And the NS1 protein will interfere with the expression, the cellular gene expression profile. It will interfere with viral DNA replication, and it will modify, alter signaling cascades in the cytosol. And as a result of these multiple changes, there will be alteration of this organization of the cytoskeleton, and alteration divisions of multiple organelles, for instance, the mitochondria and lysosomes. And the message of this slide is that the multiplicity of the action of the virus allows the virus to circumvent resistance developed by the cells to conventional death process. And as you know, this is a major reason for the failure of chemotherapy. Tumor cells develop, which acquire resistance to these conventional treatments. And for instance, a cell which the virus here can kill the cells through apoptosis, but if the cells, the tumor cells become resistant to apoptosis, they still remain, they keep the sensitivity to the virus, because the virus will now mobilize another death pathways involving lysosomes, and I'll illustrate this later on also. So complex, multiple pathway death process. Now, as I said, one component of the mode of action of oncolytic viruses is immune modulation, and this is also the case of H1 parvovirus, and I would like just now to provide two pieces of evidence, in vitro pieces of evidence for this immunomodulating activity. So this is an experiment where tumor cells were infected or not with the virus, and the effect of infection was investigated at the level of the interaction of these tumor cells with NK cells. And under conditions where the virus itself is less, the virus is not always able to kill all tumor cells, so these are cells which were not very sensitive to the virus. So under conditions where the virus itself or the NK cells alone were very inefficient in killing the tumor cells, the infection of the tumor cells allowed, sensitized much these cells to the killing effect of the NK cells, and this synergistic killing effect could be ascribed to the induction in infected cells of ligands to activating receptors on NK cells. The next slide shows another example, in vitro example, of immunomodulating effect of the virus. Here we look at the effect of the virus on the infection by the virus of tumor cells, in this case melanoma cells, on the capacity of these oncolysates for activating the maturation, for inducing the maturation of dendritic cells, leading to the cross-presentation of tumor-associated antigens to a CTL clone specific for this tumor, and whose activation leads to a production of interferon gamma. Now, if you compare the death process induced by UV radiation or simply cycles of freeze and thaw to the death process induced by the virus, you see that the virus is much more efficient in inducing an immunogenic type of cell death, and this could be traced back to the presence in the oncolysate of different pathogen or damage-associated patterns such as HSPs. Now, in vivo, these immunostimulating effects can also be detected, revealed in animal models through immunodepletion experiments, through adoptive transfer experiments, and I'm just illustrating here one of the recent experiments that was performed in the lab. In this experiment, the tumor and the PBMCs from one single patient pancreatic cancer patient. So both the tumor and the PBMCs were collected. The tumor could be engrafted into immunodeficient animals, and this allows to test the direct oncolytic effect of the virus. One can inject the virus in these tumors in an immunodeficient environment and see whether the virus by itself will interfere with the growth of the tumor. And on the other hand, we look at the effect of the virus. We looked at the effect of the virus on the priming of the PBMCs ex vivo by incubation of these cells with pancreatic cancer cells infected or not with the virus prior to the reconstitution of the animal. And this allows to measure the direct oncolytic effect of the virus, but also the ability, the adjuvant effect of the virus when it is administered to the cell vaccine. And these experiments show that indeed both components are important, and that a full tumor remission can be obtained when the virus is both injected into the tumors to induce a direct kick effects and also used to as an adjuvant to the vaccination process ex vivo. Now, a last remark, because all these, of course, these are model systems, so they are very artificial, but before moving to the real human situation, I would like to make a last remark, which is depicted by this slide and shows that one can modulate the potency of the virus. One can enhance the oncolytic effect of the virus, and I'm not going to illustrate this in this meeting, but there are ways to modify the virus to make it more oncolytic. But there are also ways to modulate its immunostimulating activity, and this was attempted in these experiments by inserting CpG elements in a non-coding region of the virus. So these CpG elements will not interfere with the replication of the virus, so this virus, this modified virus, will be as will be replication competent and as oncolytic, not more but not less, compared with the one-time virus. But now it will differ from the one-time virus, because when it lyses cells, it will lead to the release of additional PAMs, namely the CpG elements which are harbored by the viral DNA, and we test whether indeed this virus has an enhanced adjuvant effect, and this was tested in this model. This is an hepatoma lung metastasis model where an autologous tumor vaccine is tested for its effect, for its capacity for preventing the appearance of these lung metastases, and the vaccine was infected or not with the virus, and indeed we found that the efficacy of the vaccine was increased by infection and further increased by arming the virus with CpG elements correlating with the presence of activated dendritic cells in the draining lymph node. So there are ways to engineer the virus to make it more immunostimulating. Now I would like to move to specific to illustrate the mode of action of the virus for a specific tumor, and this will lead us to the human situation. And this tumor is a glioma multiforme, which is the most, as you know, most primary primary brain tumor, and it is a tumor with a devastating prognosis. Dreadful prognosis. The patients have an overall survival expectancy of 1 to 1.5 years after the first diagnosis of the tumor, in spite of all the progress made in surgery and also chemo and radiotherapy. So it is one of the tumors calling for innovative treatments, and therefore a number of clinical trials using oncolytic viruses are conducted in glioma patients. So we first tested whether the virus, the oncolytic parvovirus H1PV, had an effect on these tumors, and we first used preclinical animal models, and this is a rat model of glioblastoma, which was injected with the virus intratumorally in this case, and you see that as a function of days, within a week or two after the injection of the virus, the tumor fully regresses. The same thing can be achieved through intravenous administration of the virus, intranasal administration of the virus. There are no side effects, and the animals also get vaccinated, so they become resistant to a challenging dose of the tumor cell. So in this system too, the immune system plays a role. We tested this through immunodepletion experiments, so now we look at the effect of the virus and also CD8 cells. In the absence of both, there is a devastating drastic increase of the tumor. In the presence of the virus alone or the CD8 plus cells alone, these cells on the virus alone put a brake on virus growth, but they do not suppress viral growth, and a full suppression is only achieved where both components can act together. So there is clearly a cooperative effect of the two agents in this system, and they have to play together to achieve the full suppression. Now, human cells can also be targets. Human glioma cells can also be targets for parvoviruses. And just illustrate this, here we look at oncolytic effects, and I just illustrate 2 points. First, this shows that the virus is able to kill glioma cells which became resistant to conventional inducer of apoptosis, for instance. And this goes back to the remark I made previously. If a cell becomes resistant to conventional death induction, it can still be killed by the virus, because the viruses find other ways to kill the cell. And in the present case, the way used by the virus to kill these apoptosis-resistant cells is through changes at the level of the lysosomes, and in particular the cathepsins, the lysosomal proteases, which normally are confined to the lysosomes, are first induced, and in addition, there is a permeabilization of the lysosomes, and as you can see here, the cathepsins are released into the cytosol, and through the different silencing approaches, we could show that it is the accumulation of these proteases in the cytosol which lead eventually to the death of the cell. So these in vitro data led us to apply for a clinical trial, which was approved and launched at the end of 2011. It is a phase one study in recurrent glioma patients, showing a recurrence of the tumor in spite of radio and chemotherapy. So the purpose of the study is phase one, two, so it's 2A. So the purpose is to demonstrate the safety of the virus, but also to get some first evidence for efficacy. This work is performed at the neurosurgery hospital of the university. The surgeon involved is Carsten Gelenicki, and the protocol is depicted here. The patient is treated either intratumorally or intravenously with the virus, and then so there are two arms, and in both arms, then after 9 days, a relatively short period after the beginning of the treatment, the tumor is resected, and the virus is administered. The same dose of virus is administered again in the cavity left by the surgeon. So this study has just been completed, so its evaluation is still in progress, but I would like to show you some of the research accompanying this study, because I think it illustrates the activity of the virus in not only in the rat or in the cell cultures, but also in the patient, and shows that immune modulation is part of this activity. And so the material we have to conduct this research is first a tumor, which is resected 9 days after the treatment, so a short period of time after the treatment, and then blood, which is collected all along the procedure. But I would like first to show some features of the tumor resected from a patient which was treated with the virus 9 days before. And the analysis of these tumors by FISH shows that the virus gets distributed, it gets spread through the tumor, it is not inert, it initiates its replication, and in at least some cells, this replication goes up to the level of expression of the NS1 protein, this protein responsible for the replication and also the cytotoxic, the cytokine, cytocidal effect of the virus. I said that in the human in vitro systems and rat, in the in vivo in the rat also, the induction of cathepsin contributes to the death of the glioma cells. This induction is also seen in the human situation. By the end of the talk, I'll be able to master this very well. So the analysis of the patient tumors shows that the zones which are positive for NS1, which is shown here in red, so the area where the tumor cells replicate the virus and express the cytotoxic proteins, are also showing in green a massive induction of cathepsin. Another feature which is more relevant to this meeting is in a significant fraction, about half of the patient, very prominent massive infiltration with T cells, which is seen revealed by the accumulation of leukocytes in the perivascular area, but also the diffusion of these in the tumor between the tumor cells, which are here labeled in red. These are the cells able to replicate the virus. I should say that these cells also show, these infiltrating cells show also sign of activation. They consist mostly in CD4 and CD8 cells, and they show markers of general markers of activation, different gamma receptors and IL-2 and receptor, and also CTL specific activation markers, perforin and granzyme B. Now, all these changes are very likely to be induced by the virus because they are not seen in historical controls or at a much lower level. The situation is always complicated. Tumors are heterogeneous. There is spontaneously some infiltration of tumors, some expression of cathepsins, but there's a striking difference between the historical controls and the injected patients. And these effects are mostly seen in the high dose. This is a dose escalation study, and they are mostly seen in the high dose groups. Now, as I said, the tumor is resected shortly after the treatment, 9 days, and this led us to wonder whether there were indeed longer lasting sequels to the treatment of the virus. And this was analyzed in patients, such as the one which is shown here, and the history of this patient is shown on the middle panel. So this patient underwent the treatment which I just described, so the intratumoral injection of the virus, and then resection and intracavitial administration of the virus. And unfortunately, this patient showed a recurrence after 10 months, which is already long compared with controls, but unfortunately, the virus was not able to prevent the recurrence, and which led to a second resection after 13 months, more than a year after the first treatment. So we had tumor material immediately, shortly, and a year after the administration of the virus. And the analysis of this material showed the persistence of viral imprints as determined even by fish. So there is a persistence of the virus in the organism, and this is consistent with the animal data showing that these viruses induce persistent infection. These infections are pathogenic, aclinical. There are no signs of this persistence, but the virus remains there. And on the other hand, we could analyze blood collected from these patients, and these patients which undergo these repeated viral surgical treatment show a very impressively increased survival of several years or more, allowing to test for the presence of changes in the blood at a different time after the treatment. And this was done in particular in collaboration with ProImmune, looking for reactive T cells in the peripheral blood by interferon gamma ELISpots. And you see on this histogram in yellow, the appearance of T cells reactive to viral antigens in this patient, mostly the NS epitopes, but also to a significant extent the capsid protein epitope, and to the border line, but still significant level against the glioma epitopes. So there is the induction of a T cell response, and the presence of these reactive T cells can be demonstrated years after the initial treatment, which could be quoted as a possible memory response, but could also be result from the persistence of the virus and the continuous representation of the antigens. Now, this peripheral blood T cell response is observed in the majority of the patients, both in the intravenous and intratumoral group. And very interestingly, it is in particular directed against the viral non-structural protein NS1. This is a replicative protein. This protein is not present in the virion. It is produced during the replication of the virus. And therefore, one can assume that these peripheral blood T cell responses are induced as a result of the replication of the virus in the tumor. And indeed, there is a very good correlation between evidence for virus replication in the tumor at day 9 or 10 after the treatment and the later detection of this T cell response in the peripheral blood. And this, of course, gives hope that by infecting glioma cells, the virus may possibly induce antiviral reaction, but possibly also anti-glioma responses. And we have indeed hints for anti-glioma responses in a significant fraction of the relevant patients, but at a low level, which may be due to technical reasons. So this question remains to be quoted, to export. Now I'll finish there, because of course this raises the question, what is the benefit for the patient of all this? As I said, the trial is still being evaluated, so I'm not supposed to disclose too much about it, but I would like still to say that this analysis confirmed first that the virus is fully innocuous, so the maximum tolerated dose has not been reached, there are no side effects at all, the specificity, the selectivity of the virus is confirmed. So this was shown in the rat. In the rat, everything was taking place in the tumor within the brain, and nothing could be seen in the normal brain or in the normal tissues. And apparently, in humans, there are at least we can of course conduct this analysis, but there are no side effects associated with the treatment. And on the contrary, if there is something, it goes in the positive direction. There is an increase in the overall lifespan of the patient, in particular those experiencing two rounds of treatment with the virus, and these patients show a strikingly increase in survival and cases of tumor remission and stabilization. So there is hope that this treatment has some effect, but it should certainly now be further improved, because it didn't prevent the primary recurrence of the tumor. The effects are long-term effects and not immediate early effects. So I would like to conclude by showing by the following claims. So I think that our data allow us to say that the oncolytic rodent protoparvoviruses are promising anti-cancer agents, because they are non-pathogenic for humans, and they have oncosuppressive properties in various model systems through direct oncolysis and immune-mediated effects. Phase 1-2A confirms that the virus is safe. It also shows that clearly the virus is active, it replicates, it induces the production of death effectors. The NS1 is a viral death effectors, the cathepsin is cellular death effectors. It leads to infiltration and specific T cell responses, and possibly some signs of clinical improvement. Now, this is the last point. I have no time to really develop, but it's clear that it's possible to engineer second-generation parvoviruses or to devise combination strategies which have an improved clinical efficacy compared with the treatment. I illustrate this for the CpG arming of the virus, but with a portfolio of other changes or other combination treatments which allow the suppression of tumors under conditions where the wild-type virus alone is not very efficient, at least in animal models. So, last but not least, I would like to thank the people who did most of this work, and those in red are the people involved in the analysis of the clinical trial data, and special mention to Jeremy, because all the ELISpot analysis and also the identification of the VAU and glioma epitopes was done in collaboration with ProImmu. So thank you for your attention.
But
yeah, right. Most of the data I showed concern patients who were intratumorally injected. But it's true, the virus can cross the blood-brain barrier. If you inject it intravenously, you see the invasion of the virus within the tumor. You see masses of FISH-positive cells around vessels, and then distribution of these cells in the tumor. In the rat system, we could show that this is not dependent on the alteration of the vasculature due to the tumor. So in the rats, in the absence of tumor, you can see that indeed the virus is able to penetrate the normal brain. It doesn't do anything there. It is inert in the normal brain, but it still can penetrate. So it's not dependent on the alteration, at least in the animal, it's not dependent on the alteration of the vasculature due to the presence of the tumor.
Yeah.
How does it affect the microglia? Yeah, no, we looked at the effect, of course, on many, many normal cells, and in the present case, microglial cells, normal astrocytes, and they either are totally refractory to infection or undergo an abortive infection, which doesn't lead to any detectable cell killing effect.
Kind of related to that question, if you're going to try and target for different kinds of cancers, do you need to understand the viral tropism, or is that the virus is targeting?
So it's not that this virus is specific for gliomas, and indeed we have a number of models in the lab which we are studying for their interaction with the parvo. For instance, pancreas is one of them, and there is a pilot pancreas study which will be initiated soon. Lymphomas, we have some models with breast cancer cells. So it's not that there is a tropism, a tissue tropism. It seems to be more a tropism for something which is rather general, so but this is a bit vague, but it's not that we identified one tumor marker. People would like to have this, so we can say, oh, here we have the marker, the indicator, which allows to predict responsiveness. Here it seems to be rather a general, it's a general property of malignant progression.
Do you see this as being the same for the other, I think, so there are about 12 viruses?
But it's very, some of them are more tropic, more tissue tropic. But the comparison of the efficiency of the virus is difficult. It's not done in system, and it's an emerging field. And indeed, there is certainly a need for a comparison of the viruses. And now we are not yet at that stage when they are compared, but the conditions are different, models are different, and it's very difficult. Everyone thinks, I have a very good virus, and it is the best. But it's very hard to compare them. But indeed, some are more tropic. For instance, the herpes virus is very efficient against melanoma, but not against lymphomas, for instance. So there are some viruses show a preference for certain targets. Now, I don't say that the parvo has no preference at all. It's not that we screen the hundreds of different tumors, and it's all heavy work, so it is punctual, but it's not that there is any specificity for a particular tumor identified so far. Now, of course, one tumor is not one tumor. You have all the heterogeneity of the tumors, and I had no time to go to the story of the glioma. The gliomas are very heterogeneous, so the picture I built is a bit of caricature, because of course tumors are much more complicated, and there are many things in a glioma which are not tumor cells. And again, if you compare different cell lines derived from a single, from the same tumor entity, there are variations between these cell lines. And we have a whole program now trying to identify signatures by comparing these cells for the permissiveness factors, which would allow to predict that a patient would indeed be more responsive than another.
If you ever see escape variants, they would be very terrible things, I would imagine.
That's very right. We have to select. It's not that they are frequent. We have to select for such escape variants by infecting cells through several rounds of infection. And indeed, we could isolate, but it's very interesting because we could isolate indeed rare variants which turned out to be retro differentiated, which came back to, which were normalized, let's say. They will, but it's in the model system. This is in vitro, so it's very hard to say more than that. But in vitro, the rare resistant escape variants were normalized compared with the original population. But you are right, I mean, this is a biological agent. One may expect that some cells could eventually escape, and I think this will be the case, and the importance of bystander effects, for instance, to complement the action of the virus or combination treatments. And we have very interesting, intriguing combination data, the parvo plus all the treatments, allowing to somehow circumvent this this issue. But it's not taking place at a high frequency.
One last question?
It's related to this question. So since this is a biological system, you expect also scab, you expect mutation of the virus. Is there any follow-up study to see the clearance of the virus? And definitely all the agents will ask for this. So as if you go further as therapeutic.
The virus is not cleared in the sense that it persists, but there is very little shedding. And there is also, of course, like all viruses, if you propagate the viruses in series, you will have, of course, mutants. But this is not taking place at a high frequency. For instance, the agent we inject cannot be distinguished at its genomic sequence level from the initial molecular clone from which it was produced through a number of rounds of transfection and then infection. So it's but definitely they are mutants, but they remain a minor fraction of the population, and they do not emerge in these studies.
Thank you.